Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So inshallah, my dear brothers, I had to do today's khutbah on very short notice, so inshallah we'll do a very easy topic. So today's topic is that sometimes, in some occasions, perfection can be the enemy of good. Or, I don't know how the saying goes, but there's a common saying, great is the enemy of good, or perfection is the enemy of good. But the basic concept is that if you try to be perfect at level one of something, anything, chances are that you'll not be able to get to level two that way. Yes, if you want to perfect and master level two, then you have to master level one. And if you did not master level one, chances are how can you master level two? You know, you don't have level one. How can you get level two? But it doesn't mean that if you have not mastered level one, that you cannot move to level two. I'll give you a simple example from my own life. In mathematics, in elementary school, I was okay. But in high school, I found it very difficult. So, for example, linear equations was okay. But then quadratic equations was more difficult. I didn't really get it too much. And then advanced functions was more difficult. And, you know, I didn't really get it. And first year university was, calculus especially, was the most difficult. And you had to do all these mathematical proofs. And I was like, how am I supposed to prove this? It doesn't make any sense. So I did not master that level. I was getting like C's, maybe B minus C's, sometimes D's even. But alhamdulillah, at one point in second year university when I was taking linear algebra, something just clicked. Something happened, wallahu alam. Maybe it's because I was taking some Islamic classes which included mantiq, maybe some because I was studying Arabic grammar, right? So Arabic grammar is very organized. Some people say it's very mathematical. So you know, this sometimes changes something in your mind, how you think. Maybe it was because of other courses. I don't know. Allah knows best. But something just clicked and I understood and I could prove mathematical like theorems even when the rest of the class couldn't. So the point is that you don't have to master the previous level in order to move on to the next level. And if you wait to master level one, sometimes that will prevent you from moving further at all. And the point today is that this is even true with deen. So there are levels of iman. We know from the hadith of Jibreel that there are levels, for example, of Islam, iman, and ihsan. These are levels. There are also different aspects. There are different aspects of our iman as well. Like Islam is different from iman, right? Iman means your faith in Allah, your tawakkul, your yaqeen. And Islam is your submission. So you can increase in your submission and you can increase in your iman and tawakkul and yaqeen. Right? These are two separate tracks, but they're also levels. And this is proven in the Quran when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, maybe not proven, but there's evidence, where Allah Azza wa Jalla says about the Bedouins that قالت الأعراب آمنا. The Bedouins say that we have brought iman. قل لن تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا. You did not bring iman. Tell them that they did not bring iman. Rather, they have just become Muslim. ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم. Iman has not yet entered into your hearts. So there's levels. Islam is the lowest level. Then there's iman. And then there's ihsan from the hadith of Jibril. And there's other words as well. For example, Allah mentions in the Quran the term waliyullah. Ala inna awliya Allahi la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahzanun. So the awliya of Allah, that's one level. There's abrar as well. Allah mentions in the Quran, inna kitab al-abrari lafi billiyin. Inna al-abrara yashrabuna min ka'sin kana mizajuha kafura. So Allah mentions all these levels. And there are other ahadith in which, you know, people talk about different levels like the Abdal and the Qutub. And I'm not familiar with those hadith, but anyways, there are many, many levels. Today, inshallah, let us discuss the highest level of a believer. What is the highest level that a believer can get to? You tell me, what is the name for the highest level? Siddiq is one contender, yes. That's sometimes said to be the highest level. There's even higher level, actually. You can debate about it. I'm not saying this is 100%, but there's one more word that ulama, they say this is the highest level. Shuhada? No. Because siddiq is higher than shuhada.
Yaqeen?
Sorry?
Al-yaqeen?
Al-yaqeen? Not quite. This is the word abd, actually. And it's very interesting because abd is, everyone's abd, even non-Muslim is abd, right? Even non-Muslims are abd, so it's the name for the lowest level, but it's also the name for the highest level. Why? Why do ulama say this? Because what is the best creation of Allah Azza wa Jalla? the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he is the best creation out of mankind, jinnkind, everything. Anything that Allah created, our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he is the best. Sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And in this dunya, when he was alive, what is the closest he achieved to, what, when was it when he was the closest to Allah Azza wa Jal? During Isra and Mi'raj, right? When he went for Isra and Mi'raj, he was the closest to Allah than he has ever been. Is true or false?
True.
True, right? And on this occasion, Allah Azza wa Jal says, Subhanalladhi asra bi abdi. So ulama say that Allah always mentions the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam with a title, an honorific title. Ya ayyuhan nabi, ya ayyuhan rasul, ya ayyuhan muzammil, ya ayyuhan muddathir. So on the best occasion, when he is the closest to Allah, Allah mentioned the word abd, which means this is the highest rank of believer. It's also the lowest rank, okay? But it's also the highest rank. You know, in the octet, you go do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. So do is the lowest and same concept. So the word abd, this is the highest level of believers, and Allah Azza wa Jal, he mentions, remember a few weeks ago we talked about Allah mentions what it means to be a good person, ayatul bir, what it means to be a smart person, the ayat about the ulul albab. How can Allah not mention the qualities of the abd, the greatest rank of the believers? And indeed Allah mentions this in Surah Furqan. It's the last passage of Surah Furqan. Allah says, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ, and then he continues, and Allah Azza wa Jal in many ayat lists all the qualities of the highest level of believers. So let us inshallah today go through some of these qualities. We won't have time to go through all of them. Let's go through some of these qualities to understand what are the qualities and the qualifications for the highest level of believers, so that we could start to inculcate them in our lives. We're all sinners, and none of us is perfect. Certainly I have not even perfected the first level of iman. But that should not stop me, it should not stop you from inculcating the highest level qualities as well. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا. This is the first quality. It's translated as they walk on the earth with humility. يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا. But hawn doesn't mean humility. What's the word for humility in Arabic actually?
Easy symbol. Easy symbol, something like
that.
Tawadu? Tawadu. That's the word for humility in Arabic. Tawadu. They didn't say mutawadi'an. They walk on the earth with, as humble people. Allah Azza wa Jalla used hawn. Hawn means weakness, meekness, frailty. So these people are frail, they're meek. This is very interesting and very counterintuitive. Yes, when it comes to the enemies of Islam, the believers show toughness. In fact, even in Hajj, you know, you uncover your right shoulder for the first three cycles. You know, that harkens back to when you're supposed to show strength against the enemies of Islam. When it comes to the enemies of Islam, you show Muslims are organized, intellectual, intelligent, strong, you know, muscular, physically, mentally, emotionally, everything. But in general, especially amongst each other, the Muslims are humble in such a way that Allah uses hawn, that they are weak, they are meek, they are frail with each other. You know, the Prophet ﷺ says that al-mu'minu hayyin layyin. The mu'min is hayyin and layyin. He is meek, he's frail. Not physically. I don't mean physically, I'm just exaggerating when I do this. But yani, in his words, in his talking to people, he is very frail and weak and meek. Hayyin, that's what hayyin means. Layyin doesn't mean lenient, it's always translated as lenient. No, layyin means malleable. Malleable. You can tell him what to do and he'll do it. In fact, the Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith, حَيْثُمَ قِيدَ إِنْقَادْ. Wherever he is led, he goes. The Prophet ﷺ in another hadith, I'm paraphrasing, but he came across two brothers. One of those brothers was very shy, very timid, you know. He had lent some money to somebody, the term was up, and it had come time for him to ask for his money back. Now this is his right. He needs to ask for the money back. Obviously he should return it, but if he's not returning it, you can ask. This is your right. There's nothing wrong with that. And however, this person, he was too shy to do this. He was too shy to ask for his own right. He was too timid. So his brother was reprimanding him. He was yelling at him. He was saying, this is your money. You should ask for it back. Why aren't you asking for it back? Why are you such a wuss? Right? So he was telling this to him. And the Prophet ﷺ walked by and he said, leave him alone. Because this is his haya. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, "Wal haya'u shu'batun min al-iman." This is his haya, and haya is a branch of iman. Now, he wasn't just being humble, he was actually being timid, actually a little bit even weak, you could say. So it's, I'm not saying this is true, but it is as if the Prophet ﷺ is painting a picture of a believer that he is a pushover. Not, he's not a pushover, but it's as if you get that picture. He's very, very shy, very small, you know, very humble. Humble is the right word, but you know, it's more than this. I just really wanted to explain this, right? It's not just humble. So this is the way in which the believer, he walks on the earth. He's very humble, very timid, very soft spoken, very gentle. He speaks to people very gently. Even if they're yelling at him, he's very, very gentle. This is the highest level, this is the first quality of the people of the highest level, the Ibad al-Rahman. Now what about people like me? If any of you know me personally, you know that at work, I'm not like this at all. You put someone like with my personality into a room with 50, 60 other people, chances are, within a few hours, I'll be the leader. I'll be saying, okay, you guys, can you please do this? And me and you, brother, I think we should do this. I'll be calling the shots. It's not out of arrogance. It's just part of the DNA. I can't help it. And many people are like this. It's a, you know, in the DISC assessment for personalities, it's the D. So I'm a very strong D. I can't help it. It's very difficult. So how should people like this, like you and me, if you share this quality, how would people like you and me, how are we supposed to be humble? At the very least, for people like us, we have to own up to our mistakes. If we make a mistake, own up to it. Say, I screwed up, I messed up, and I'm going to correct it. Let's own up to our mistake. And when it comes, when praise is being given, people with this quality love to receive praise. So when praise is being given, distribute it out to everyone. Don't keep that praise for yourself. Distribute it to, like, no, this brother helped me do this. He's the real hero here. Like, to spread out that, to be humble. You know what it means? You know what I'm trying to say, right? To be humble in general. So this is the first quality of the highest ranking believers. يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. And when the jahil people talk to them, they say, salam, peace. Okay, the word jahil here, it needs some understanding. It doesn't just mean ignorant people. The word jahil, obviously it's the opposite of aql. Aql comes from the word iqal. Iqal is the rope that you use to tie your animal so it doesn't run away. Right? So what it means, so you know, they took this rope, they tied it, they tied the animal to the wall or to the fence or something. And when they were riding the animal, the Arabs, they took that rope and they wrapped it around their heads, right? Just to somewhere to keep it. So, you know, nowadays even you see Arab brothers, they're wearing that black circle on top of their heads, right? So that nowadays it's just for fashion. But back in the day, that was the iqal. That was the thing that you tied your animal with. So anyways, the idea is that the aql is something that ties your emotions. You don't just say what comes into your heart. Not everything that you feel, you just say. The aql is a filter between your emotions and what you say, what you speak, what comes out of your mouth. And jahl is the absence of that aql, of that filter. Jahil is someone who does not have a filter. Anything that comes to his mind, he just says it. So these people might swear and curse. These people might backbite and talk about other people. These people might spread gossip. These people talk about topics that they have no knowledge of, but they talk about it as if they're experts. These are people who spread gossip. These are people who talk about lewd things, crass things, uncouth things. These are people who just say whatever comes to their mind. This is the essence of jahl. And indeed, it's the main, Allah knows best, but it's the main meaning here. That what not only do the believers not do this, but the highest ranking believers, whenever people like this come to them, they say, they don't do Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi al-Munkar. This is not the time for Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi al-Munkar. This is not the time, right? This is the time to say, okay, salam brother, peace. I know, you're right. I'm the one who's wrong here. I gotta go do some stuff, inshallah. You're right. So just diffuse the situation. The believers, they diffuse the situation. They don't listen to things that are uncouth. They don't listen to things that are crass. They don't listen to things that are crude and lewd. They say, peace, I have to go. Obviously, they don't do it themselves either. They don't talk like this themselves either. Allah Azza wa Jal also mentions, وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. And they spend the night, سُجَّدًا in sajda, وَقِيَامًا and standing. Meaning they spend the night remembering Allah Azza wa Jal. وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اصْرِفْ عَنَّا عَذَابَ جَهَنَّمَ إِنَّ عَذَابَ كَانَ غَرَامًا إِنَّهَا سَاءَتْ مُسْتَقَرًّا وَمُقَامًا. And they are people who say, oh Allah, protect us from Jahannam. We don't want to go to Jahannam because it is a terrible place to stay for a long time or even for a little bit of time. So you know how some people say, inshallah, I will ask for forgiveness later. Right? Who guaranteed that there's going to be a later? Another group of people, they say, inshallah, Allah will forgive me. Yani they have no intention of even asking for forgiveness. They say, inshallah, Allah is Ghafoor Rahim, He will forgive me. What guarantee do we have that Allah will forgive that sin, so-and-so sin? We don't have a guarantee. And then there's a third category of people who will say, yes, we'll go to Jahannam. لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. Yes, we'll go to Jahannam, but we're Muslim. Allah will eventually take us out of Jahannam and we'll go to Jannah. These people, the Ibad al-Rahman, they recognize, obviously we don't want to stay in Jahannam forever, but we don't even want to touch it. We don't even want to see it. We don't even want to lay eyes on it. On the Day of Judgment, Jahannam will have a neck, and it will have a face, and it will have a roar, and it will raise its head up. It will see all the believers and non-believers, and it will let out a huge scream that will be so intense, so, in Urdu you say, holnak, right? It will be so scary that everybody will faint. These people, they don't even want to see Jahannam. They don't even want to touch it. The scholars, they say, forgive us, O children. They talk to their children, they say, forgive us. We could not get more money for you. We could not get more dunya for you because your father is afraid of Jahannam. He cannot stand in Jahannam. قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. Save yourself, protect yourself from Jahannam and you and your family. وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. So these are people, number one, they are extremely humble. Even you could say they're a little meek and timid, especially amongst each other, amongst the Muslims. Number two, whenever somebody talks to, not only do they not talk about lewd and bad things, when someone talks to them about these things, they say, peace brother, I have to go. Number three, they spend the night in tahajjud. They spend the night remembering Allah Azza wa Jal. Sujjadan wa qiyama. And number four is that they ask for protection from Jahannam. They fear Jahannam. You know, sometimes some brothers get caught up in the, some Muslims, they get caught up in the idea that we should only do something because of our love for Allah Azza wa Jal. This is true ikhlas. If you do not do something for just the love of Allah, then your ikhlas is incomplete. That's actually not true. There are three legitimate niyas. Number one is to do something out of the love and slavery of Allah Azza wa Jal. That is obviously a legitimate niyah. The second one is to gain entry into Jannah, to gain, you know, Jannah, to gain Allah's favor so that we can have the bounties of Jannah and increase our levels in Jannah. To do something because you want Jannah is a legitimate, perfectly fine niyah for doing something. There's nothing wrong with that at all. In fact, it is part of our iman. One of the branches of iman is to desire Jannah. And number three is to do something out of the fear for Jahannam. You want to protect yourself from that pain and that punishment. This is a completely legitimate niyyah, and it does not decrease from a person's ikhlas. So, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا أَنفَقُوا لَمْ يُسْرِفُوا وَلَمْ يَقْتُرُوا وَكَانَ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ غَوَامًا. This is very interesting. Allah is talking about, first Allah talked about the interactions these people have with other human beings. Two things, hawn and qalu salama, right? So Allah mentioned two things about the interaction with other people. Then Allah mentioned two things about their iman and their a'mal. And He mentioned, one, tahajjud, and number two, they make dua for protection from Jahannam. Number three, Allah mentions their sort of, you could say family life, or you could say their personal life. Ustad Norman says their shopping habits. So Allah mentions the shopping habits of the people of the highest level of iman. Look how important this is. Allah is talking about Ibad al-Rahman, the highest level of iman, right? And He mentions shopping habits. And He says when they spend money, infaq doesn't just mean charity. It means when you spend money, these people, lam yusrifu, they don't go overboard, walam yaqturu, and they're not cheap. وَكَانَ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ قَوَامًا. They're between. They take the middle road. Israf Isra, there are two words that Allah uses in the Quran for being too excessive. Number one is Isra. Number two is Tabdir. So Tabdir is mentioned in Surah Bani Israel, right? So Allah mentions these two. Israf means when you spend on things that you don't even need. And you go overboard in things that you didn't even need to, you didn't even need them to begin with. So for example, I don't know, something I don't need. Let's say I already have a computer. But I love technology, so I buy another computer. And not only do I buy another computer, not only is it just another laptop that I don't need and I'm probably not even going to use, but it's like $5,000. Right, that's a ridiculous price for a laptop. So this would be considered israf for me. Maybe for someone who's rich, it's not israf. But for me, this would be israf. Tabdir is that you need it anyways. I don't have a watch, let's say, and I'm buying this watch. But in buying this watch that I need, I go overboard. I spend $10,000. I buy a Patek Philippe, so I spend $300,000 on a watch. You know, that's ridiculous, especially for my salary, right? That's ridiculous. So this would be considered tabdir. So these people do not do israf, and they do not do, they're not qatur, they're not cheap, they don't cheap out. You know, when you go to the grocery store, they don't say, well, we ate yesterday, do you need to eat again? You know, they're not cheap, right? They spend on their family. So we learned in Ayatul Bir that to be a good person, these people, despite the love of wealth, they spend on their family. Now why is spending, not being too excessive and not being too cheap, why is this so important to the high, in fact it's highest level of iman, Allah mentions it. Why is this so important? Because majority of our day we're spending earning money, and the time that we're not spending earning money, we're spending money. So money is a huge part of our life. And not only that, but money is is actually you. It's a part of you. Think about it. You're trading your time and you get something in return, and that something in return is money and benefits and whatever else that you get, right? So that money that you get is in exchange for the time that you gave. And everyone has the same amount of time, right? Roughly, you know, roughly speaking, the average age. Everyone's time is equal. That's what I mean to say. Everyone's time is equal. You have 1 second, I have 1 second. It's the same second. So the people, when we go to work, we're giving our time and we're getting in exchange some money. So that money is a representative of our life. So it becomes very, very important. And that's why people love money. That's like the deep psychology, you could say, about money, because it's you. When you're looking at those bills, that's you, that's your life, right? You're never going to get it back. This money is all you have now that remains of that, you know? So this is a very important concept, where we earn our money and where we spend it. And the Prophet ﷺ said that the first five questions that a person will be asked on the Day of Judgment, two of them are regards to our money. Where did we earn it and where did we spend it? So it's not difficult to understand that Allah would mention this in the highest ranks of iman. Allah Azza wa Jal also mentioned that وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَذْكُرُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرٌ. So this is very interesting. I think I missed one. وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّهُ مَرُّوا بِكِرَامًا. Maybe that's coming later, but I want to mention it now. When they pass by people who are doing lagu. Lagu, we talked about a few weeks ago. Lagu is idle talk. It's translated as idle talk. It means you talk about something that doesn't matter. You're gonna forget about what you were talking about in 1 hour anyways. It's meaningless conversation. Now this doesn't mean that, for example, when you go to your in-laws and you know you just sit around there and your father-in-law goes, so, you know, how's life? Or, you know, how's the sports team? Or how's your work going? And you say, brother, please, this is idle conversation. Obviously, you need to spend time with family, you need to spend time with people. What are you going to talk about? You're going to talk about things that really, at the end of the day, don't matter. Right? That's okay. Right? Just taking out half an hour, taking a break from work, talking about nonsense, that's fine. But use your own judgment. A point in time comes when you've been spending hours and hours and you're talking to your friends about technology, and you do it day after day. Technology and sports and international politics, things we have no idea about even. You know, yelling commentary at people, the best athletes in the world, and you're yelling, do this, as if we're better than them. You know, like, this stuff doesn't matter. This offends Allah Azza wa Jal. You know, in Surah Muddathir, Allah Azza wa Jal talks about the people of Jannah, they're going to be asking the people of Jahannam, what made you go to hell? And they will say, لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. We didn't pray. وَلَمْ نَكُمْ نُطْعِمُ الْمِسْكِينَ. And we did not feed the poor. وَكُنَّا نَخُوضُ مَعَ الْخَائِضِينَ. We used to do khawd. Hulb means we used to dive into a topic and we used to talk about it at length, but it didn't matter at the end of the day, and we knew nothing about it anyways. This is seriously offensive to Allah Azza wa Jal, and it leads a person to Jahannam. So not only do the Ibad al-Rahman not do this, but they stay awake. Now notice the interactions, and I'll end with this, the interactions of the Ibad al-Rahman. I didn't finish, by the way, there are more qualities. But the interaction of the Ibad al-Rahman with other people, they are humble. When they come across people who are being lewd and crass and vulgar, they say, Salam brother, peace brother. And when they come across people who are talking idle talk, not bad talk, but just idle, useless talk, they marru kirama, they walk by with dignity. They walk by, that says, brother, I have stuff to do right now, I'm sorry, I'm not going to be able to spend time with you right now. Maybe later. We'll take a rain check, inshallah. Maybe later, inshallah. Let's make a date, later on we'll talk, inshallah. They leave with dignity. They don't embarrass people. They don't do amru bil ma'ruf and nahi anil munkar. Brother, you're talking about useless things. You know, you shouldn't be talking about. No, they just pass by with dignity. So, in other words, we have to look at the lazim and the malzum here. If they're not engaging with people who are talking about bad things, and they're not engaging with people who are talking about useless things, it is the lazim. It means that they are themselves are not doing bad things. It's not like they don't sit with their friends and talk about technology, and then they go home and watch Stranger Things for 5 hours in a row. No, they are productive people. It's not in the ayah, but it's lazim malzum. It necessitates it. Obviously, these people, they're not engaging with these people, so obviously, they are people who are productive throughout their day. They take a break, sure, but generally speaking, they are productive at work. They're productive in their families. They're productive in the masjid. These people are productive members of society. May Allah make us all ibad al-Rahman of the highest ranks, inshallah. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.